Welcome everybody. In this session we'll try to see what we think of happiness and prosperity today. In the last session we have tried to define what is happiness and what is prosperity, right? And what does it mean to ensure the continuity of the two. But if you look at the way we are looking at happiness and prosperity today, it is quite different. In fact, many of the questions which came in the last session were essentially born out of this prevalent notion about happiness and prosperity. So we are essentially talking about the current scenario or current, you know, prevalent notions about happiness and prosperity in this session. So let's look at that. So, last session we have, till now we have talked about this fact that holistic development means ensuring the fulfillment of the basic human aspiration, which is happiness, prosperity and its continuity. Okay. And we also said that this can be ensured through right education and sanskar. Right. So, this we have already talked about, and for this to happen, we need to ensure these three things in education system: the right understanding in the self, the fulfillment in relationship with human being, and physical facility with rest of nature. And then we said that if you look at the basic human aspiration, it is for happiness, prosperity and its continuity. And if you look at what is happiness, happiness is to be in a state of harmony. So we said to be in a state of harmony is happiness, and in contrast to this, when we are forced to be in a state of disharmony, contradiction, we are in a state of unhappiness. So that is how we define this happiness and unhappiness. Regarding the feeling of prosperity, we said prosperity means the feeling of having more than required physical facility. And to have the feeling of prosperity, two things are required. Number one, right assessment of physical needs along with their required quantity, and number two, ensuring the availability, the production of more than required physical facility. Right? If these two are ensured, then we'll have the feeling of prosperity. Otherwise, in regard of how much we accumulate, okay, if we are not able to identify the need of physical facility, we are not able to make the assessment of, you know, required physical facility, then we may go on accumulating, but we will continue to feel deprived. And one of the indicators of a prosperous person is that a prosperous person thinks of nurturing others, whereas a deprived person thinks of exploiting others. So this is what we have discussed about happiness and prosperity in the last session. Now what we want to do in this session is to see whether is this notion of happiness and prosperity clear to us today, or we have some other notions, and is that a right notion? So that is what we want to investigate into the prevailing notions of happiness and prosperity. So we said that in this lecture we want to explore the prevailing notions of happiness and prosperity, as well as the larger impact of these notions. So these notions are there, and there are certain very far-reaching impacts of these notions of happiness and prosperity. So we'll try to understand both the prevailing notions, the current scenario of happiness and prosperity, and also the impact of these notions. So let's look at this. So one of the prevailing notions about happiness and prosperity today is that if you want to ensure happiness and prosperity, what you need to do is to accumulate more and more physical facility. That is what we discussed in the very first session, right? We have come to assume that if there is enough physical facility, happiness and prosperity will automatically be ensured. Right? Can you see that? This is the prevalent notion today. That happiness and prosperity will come if we have enough physical facility. Is this what we believe? Is this what we assume?
Exactly.
Exactly. Right. So this is one of the prevailing notion about happiness and prosperity, that it can be ensured through physical facility, it can be ensured through, you know, having enough physical facility. Now if you look at this notion, it has a very wide impact, right? It has a very wide and very serious impact. So let's look at that impact. The impact or result of such a program can be seen, right? So let's look at them one by one. Now what we want to ensure happiness and prosperity is having enough physical facility. And do we know what is enough? No. So that is not clear. So then it boils down to accumulation of more and more physical facility, right? And because we don't know how much, it seems to be unlimited. So basically, to ensure happiness and prosperity, we think that we require to accumulate physical facility in an unlimited amount, right? So this is what is the program. So to ensure happiness and prosperity, the main program is accumulation of physical facility. And most of us are busy with this, right? So if you are, you know, in IIT, right, and if you do the graduation from IIT Kanpur, what is the achievement? Good job. And what is the achievement of good job? Good salary, which means good physical facilities. So if you look at your education, if you look at your development, all that is busy with this accumulation of more and more physical facility. And if you ask how much, they don't know. So that is unlimited. That is what it is think. So accumulation of physical facility seems to be the main program. But if this is the main program, then it will have many repercussions, right? Then let's see what is the impact, what is the repercussion. Which human being, the first repercussion is that when you want to accumulate more and more, you tend to exploit, right? First you try to accumulate more and more by legal means, and if the legal means are not available, you try with illegal means, right? And that is corruption, right? So first impact of this accumulation of more and more physical facility to get happiness and prosperity is exploitation of other human being. And if that exploitation takes place, will it lead to a feeling of relationship or feeling of opposition?
Opposition.
Opposition. So it leads to feeling of opposition. And then there is a struggle. Tug of war between those who are exploiting and those who are being exploited, right? And ultimately it leads to war. So the outcome of this accumulation of physical facility unlimited, you know, as far as human beings are concerned, it leads to exploitation of other human beings, therefore the feeling of opposition, therefore the struggle, and therefore the war. Even this war between the countries has to do with this, right? The war between two countries is basically this, you know, trying to exploit the resource of the other country. What else? So this is one set of repercussion. The other set of repercussion with rest of nature, right, is this. So if we are trying to exploit or accumulate more and more physical facility, we tend to engage with the rest of nature in a manner which violates the cyclic process, the cyclic and mutually enriching process, right? So violation of cyclic and mutually enriching process, right? So basically, this is being violated. So when we are interacting with the rest of nature and we are trying to accumulate more and more, right? and we don't know how much to accumulate, we go on producing more and more, right? And when we find that if it cannot be done by a mutually and cyclically enriching process, we indulge into processes which are not such, right? So we indulge with soil, with tree, with wood, with ash, with soil, everything, right? So you start digging the mines, right? The coal mines and the ore mines and all these things, right? To any depth. If this happens, there are two outcomes. One is the resource depletion. So that we can see. So there is scarcity of now the iron ore, the coal, the petrol, the diesel, right? So that resource depletion is taking place because we are consuming or exploiting at a rate much faster than the nature can produce. And the other thing is the environmental pollution. That is, we are trying to create outputs which cannot be recycled by the nature at a rate we are producing. So that output is, you know, or the byproducts are getting accumulated, which leads to pollution, the environmental pollution. And this issue of pollution has become so extreme that it has started affecting the whole environment, right? One of the implications is the rising temperature of the environment, which we call as global warming, right? So it leads to global warming. So these are the impact. In fact, if you look at the problems today that we are facing in the society, it has to do with all this, right? It has to do with the exploitation of people by other people, corruption, right? The problem of this opposition, feeling of opposition, the struggle, the war, right? Like extremism is one of such examples, right? Then at the level of nature, there is problem of this resource depletion, the environmental degradation, ultimately leading to global warming. But if you look at all these problems, they are basically related to our wrong notion of happiness and prosperity. Our wrong notion of how continuity of happiness and prosperity can be ensured, right? We tend to think that continuity of happiness and prosperity can be ensured with physical facility, right? And therefore, what we need to do is to accumulate more and more physical facility. So what we have been saying, that unless you have this right understanding and the right feeling part, any amount of physical facility will not lead either to happiness or to prosperity. And that is what is happening. When we think that we can be happy and prosperous through physical facility alone, that is what we call as living with animal consciousness, then we go on accumulating more and more. But instead of getting happiness and prosperity and its continuity, we end up in whole lot of problems like this. Right? So this is one, you know, prevalent notion about happiness and prosperity and how it can be ensured. The second thing is about notion about the prosperity. Let's look at that. We more or less come to assume or believe that prosperity means physical facility. If you have more physical facility, you are more prosperous. Right? But is that the case? If you have physical facility, does it ensure prosperity? But what we have come to believe is that happiness, prosperity means physical facility. And therefore, if you want continuous prosperity, we have to go on accumulating, right, more and more physical facility. So it leads to maximum or unlimited accumulation of physical facility, right? And we are busy doing it, even if it means struggling to meet the unlimited wants, as resources are limited. So because resources are limited and you want unlimited, you know, facility, you have to struggle, you have to fight with others, right? And that is what is happening across the family, across the state, across the nation, everywhere. So can we see that? And if you have physical facility, does it lead to prosperity? So as we clarified, there are two things required for this feeling of prosperity. Number one is to identify the need of physical facility, and number two is to produce or make available more than what is required. So physical facility does play a very important role in prosperity, but right identification of the need is also at the base. So if you are not able to identify the need of physical facility, then irregardless of how much we accumulate, we continue to feel deprived. And when you continue to feel deprived, you think of exploiting others. So today you can ask, you know, whether people who have riches, right, are they thinking of exploiting others or nurturing others? Exploiting others. So are they feeling deprived or prosperous?
They are thinking that they are prosperous.
Yeah, but are they really prosperous? So this is the notion about prosperity, okay, the prevailing notion, which is not the correct notion.
The one which is more, who is more prosperous, is more into exploitation.
Yeah. So they, in fact, substitute prosperity with accumulation. So those who have accumulated more, okay, that accumulation itself has taken place by way of exploitation, and there will be an exploitation more. So today, you say that if you have more physical facility, you are more prosperous. And then you also say that if you have more physical facility, next time you should have still more. So now they have come with this idea that how much you have is not really the issue. How much you have grown, right, is the issue. So the growth has become the point, right, not your belongings anymore.
So the main confusion is self and body
regarding. Yeah, of course, that we will come to, that ultimately the main confusion comes from the confusion between the self and the body. The need of the body is fulfilled by physical facility, right, and not the need of the self. Yes.
But also there is a recognition point is added to this while people are holding their this wealth, and suppose that they are losing the wealth to someone, and they will feel deprived because of they are not getting honor from the people.
They are not getting
honor from the people. Like when they were the highly, they were having lots of amount of money, and they were highly recognized in the society. But they lose their money, and they will not be so much recognized, or they will be down the list in so-called Forbes magazine and etc., like the Chessman, etc., these magazines.
Yeah, so that is the kind of social environment that is provided, which reinforces these kind of notions. Yeah. But see, exactly what is happening, for example, this one of the book, you know, discusses about... One of the book, you know, discusses about this. Interesting thing, you know, that 1923, a survey was made of the 8 people who are the richest people on the earth, right, 1923. And then they were surveyed 25 years after, right. And it says that these richest people, these 8 richest people on the earth, were having the wealth which was more than the wealth of the government of United States at that time. So 1923, they are having the wealth which is more than the wealth of the government of United States. And 25 years after, an account of it was taken again. And out of these 8 people, you can see what has happened. Right? The first person, the president of the largest steel company, has gone bankrupt. Right? And died bankrupt. The president of the largest gas company went insane. One of the greatest commodity trader, he died insolvent. Right? The fourth person was sent to jail. The fifth person, right, was relieved from the jail to go back home and die in peace. Right? The sixth person committed suicide. The seventh person also committed suicide. The eighth person also committed suicide. So this is the progress in 25 years of the people who were the richest people of the earth. So do you think they were feeling prosperous or they are feeling happy? But this is the prevailing notion. You want to be on the top of the list. What? Srikanth is saying that you want to be on the top of the list so that people will appreciate. So they were on the top of the list. These are the 8 people in 1923, and then in 1948. But what is it leading to? Is it leading to happiness and prosperity, or is it leading to this crisis? So good, think of it. So let's go back. So we are talking about the prevalent notions of happiness and prosperity. So we have talked about one prevalent notion of happiness and prosperity. Then we have talked about the prevalent notion of prosperity, right? Now let's look at the notion about happiness in a little more detail. So if you look at this notion about happiness, one of the source of happiness is considered to be the favorable sensation. That is, if I get the favorable sensation, it gives me happiness. And therefore, you are busy trying to get favorable sensation, right?
Yes.
So drink Coca-Cola, right? Listen to music, right? Go for an out, you know, kind of sightseeing. So these sensations will make you happy. This is one of the prevalent notions. So the basic idea, if you look at it, it says that there are physical things. These physical things, when they come in contact with the body, some sensation is generated, right, in the body, and this sensation is tested by the self. And you can see that if this sensation is favorable, then you have a feeling of happiness. If this sensation is not favorable, unfavorable, is not, you know, liked by you, it leads to unhappiness. And if you look at this nature of happiness and unhappiness, they are of course temporary. So for example, when you eat a rasgulla, a sweet, right? If this sensation of sweetness is favorable for you, you will feel happy about it. Right? If it is not favorable, if you don't like sweets, then it will lead to unhappiness. Not only that, if you like particular kind of sweet and you go to a shop with the expectation of that kind of rasgulla, right, and what you get is little different from it, right, will it lead to happiness, unhappiness?
Unhappiness.
Unhappiness. Right. And when you are getting favorable sensation from sweet, let's say, can it be temporary, can it be continuous, or it is temporary? Can you get continuous happiness out of eating rasgulla or eating any sweet? No. Only as long as you are eating that sweet, that taste will be there, right? once it goes down the throat, there is no test. So no happiness. And you can't go on eating, because after some time your stomach will be full and your throat, you know, will be full up to the throat. So the happiness that you will get out of it is temporary. But this is one major source of happiness for us today. Isn't it? And we are busy doing this. Now, what is the problem with this? One major problem is that it is temporary in nature. Right? Yes. So let's look at this, the details of this. So happiness from favorable sensation of touch, sound, form, taste, smell, right? And these sensations are obtained from indulgence with food, with sleep, with fear, you know, the security from fear, and so on. What do you find? Can you see that major part of our time is spent doing this? The major part of our time is spent on doing this. In fact, majority of our science, technology, all is put to this service. For example, we have designed an air conditioner, right? With lot of research and everything, you know? Yes. What is the end use of this air conditioner?
These are related to the sensors. So development of the sensor is a technology.
So the end use is that the feeling of touch that you get of the air in the room is favorable. That is the end outcome of an AC, right? So this is what we are doing. Majority of our time and effort is spent now for getting favorable sensation from either the sound or the touch or the form or the taste or the smell. You spend so much of time cooking food, serving food, right, eating food. All that is giving a favorable sensation of taste. These sensations can be a source of excitement. Since it provides only temporary happiness, and after some time one will get bored of it. Therefore, he will keep changing it from one sensation to another sensation. Does this happen?
Yes.
Yeah. So, good food. And after some time you get tired of eating food or get bored of eating food, then you go and listen to some music, right? Then after some time you get bored of music, then you go around for a walk, right? And so on and so forth. So it is not giving continuity of happiness, it is only giving excitement. So for some time you feel happy about it, but very soon you get bored of it. Very soon you get tired of it. Okay. Now, if you do the analysis of this, getting happiness through sensation, this is the result. So what we are saying is that sensation is not a source of continuous happiness. Right? What will happen is that when you start with something, like let's say, you know, you are very fond of eating sweet. Now you start with eating sweet, and you must have enough quantity of sweets so that you can do this experiment. So when you start eating the sweet, it is tasty and necessary. So you find the sweet tasty, therefore you want to eat it to get the favorable sensation and get happiness. And you also feel that this it is necessary for the health of the body. Right? But once your stomach is full, you may still find it tasty, but now you can see that it is unnecessary. So now you are not eating for the nurturing of the body, but you are eating it out of the taste for getting happiness through sensation. But when it is full up to the neck, then what will happen? Then it will lose the taste also. So it is tasteless and unnecessary. It is no more required for nurturing of the body, and it is also losing the taste. So that is where you reach. Now you will anyway stop. But if somebody forces you to eat sweets more, right? What will happen? Then it will be intolerable. So this is the stage through which, you know, it will always go through. So any sensation, okay, if you are trying to get happiness out of the sensation through the contact with the physical object, right, it will go through this process. Initially it will, you know, appear as tasty and necessary. After some time it will remain tasty, but it will become unnecessary. After some time it will even lose the taste, it will become, you know, tasteless and unnecessary, and you will like to stop. But if somebody forces you to eat, right, or, you know, continue with that sensation, it will become intolerable for you. Can you see that? Any sensation, eating, you know, listening to a music, sleeping, right? When, you know, you are not any more tired and your sleep is, you know, complete, right? You would like to get up. And if you're not allowed to get up, what will happen? Yeah, intolerable. It will become intolerable. Isn't it? We don't look into this, you know, we don't do this experiment at a length, so we don't realize. But if you do this experiment at length with every sensation, you will find that this is what is happening. So what Nimisha was asking, that why we are not able to see this, right? That this is not leading to continued of happiness. We are not able to see this because, number one, we are not really consistently doing this experiment, observation. Number two, we are not given this proposal from outside in our system of education to verify this, whether is it really leading to continuity of happiness, or it is bound to lead to discontinuity, you know, to something very temporary. So this is one prevalent notion, right? And this is of course dependent on the other, on the things outside, the physical things outside, and therefore it is in a way, you know, being dependent on the other. That is the pratyantata, right? So you are under the control of the outside, of the other. So this is one notion of happiness, getting happiness through favorable sensation. There is another notion which can be very clearly seen, at least in the people who have accumulated lot of physical facility and who can afford to get favorable sensation, right? And when they get favorable sensation and they find that it is not working. So if you have enough to eat, you find that you are not getting a continuity of happiness through eating, right? Then you start looking for something else, right? That something else has to do with this, the favorable feeling from the other. This will lead to happiness. That is second notion, right? So if you get respect from the people, you will get happy, right? So if you get the name, the fame, you know, you will get happiness. So you start working for that, right? So particularly people who have accumulated lot of physical facility, they have experimented with the first part, trying to get happiness through sensation, and they have found that it is not working, they take to the second one, right? So these rich people, so-called rich people, not prosperous people, the rich people, they try to make, you know, some image in the society so that they get respect, they get name, they get fame, you know, and that will give them happiness, right? So you want to buy big cars, right, to get the respect from others. You want to get big you know, big house, you know, to get respect. You pay donations to get respect. You make old age home, right? All this is done to get the respect, get the feeling from the other. And the expectation is that this will lead to happiness. If you look at this notion, right, this also has the same kind of problem, right? So it depends on the other human being. The other human being is expressing his feeling for you. This feeling is received by you and evaluated by you. If this feeling is found to be favorable, then you feel happy. If this feeling is found to be unfavorable, you feel unhappy. Somebody is respecting you, giving you respect, you feel happy. Somebody is disrespecting you, you feel unhappy. Does this happen?
Yes.
Yeah. So the clothes that you wear, the house that you make, the car that you buy, now most of these things have become, you know, a source for you to get respect from the other and get therefore happiness through this respect. So you want to buy branded clothes paying 100,000 rupees, the same t-shirt which can be bought for 100 rupees without the brand. Why are you buying this branded t-shirt?
Status symbol.
Yeah? Status symbol, which means to get respect. You want to show that you are of a higher status, you know, so that people will respect you. So this is second source of happiness as far as the prevalent notion is concerned. Now if you look at this notion, this feeling from the other cannot be source of continuous happiness, because there is no way to ensure this continuity of feeling from the other. It will depend upon his mood. It will depend upon his state of mind, right? So if you go with a big car, he will pay attention. If somebody else comes with a bigger car, you are lost. Even if somebody has not come with a bigger car, right, first time he will look at your car, right, pay attention, then forget about it. He has so many other things to do. So this getting happiness from the feeling from other cannot be a source of continuous happiness. That is the problem. And it is also dependent on the other, right, not in yourself. So you are in a state of, you know, pratantrita, in a state of being dictated by the other. So this second notion also does not work. The first notion of getting happiness through sensation does not work. The second notion of getting happiness through favorable feeling also does not work. So that is where we are. In fact, there are many such notions, right? We can look into each one of them, right? So if you just list them up, they look like this. I will not get into the details of all this, but I'll read it out. Physical facility leads to happiness. Sensation leads to happiness. Excitement leads to happiness. So we try to create excitements, right? So most of these amusement parks now, right, they are out to create excitement. Okay. So at least for some time you will get happiness, right? Domination gives happiness, so we are trying to dominate others. Fulfillment of all desires will lead to happiness, so we are trying to fulfill all desires, right? So these are the prevalent notions. And unfortunately, none of them is able to be the source of continuous happiness. None of them is able to ensure continuity of happiness for you. Of course, all of them have some role to play, right? All of them have some role to play, but they cannot be the source of continuous happiness. So it is not that they are not important, they are not useful. They are useful. They have some role to play. But there is some definite role that they can play, right? But they cannot be the source of continuous happiness. So only when you have the right understanding of happiness and you are able to ensure it through right understanding and right feeling in the self, then you can place all of these things in a proper way. So let's look at that. With right understanding, all of them can be placed properly. This notion of physical facility can now be seen, right, as a source for right utilization of physical facility. And what is the right utilization of physical facility? Nurturing of the body is one of them, right? Protection of the body and so on, right? So physical facility is important for what? For nurturing of the body, for protection of the body, but it cannot be the source of continuous happiness. This is what we can see with right understanding, right? Similarly, sensation is happiness. Sensation is important, but it cannot be the source of continuous happiness. Sensation is important in the sense that it can be used for keeping the body healthy. So one use is, you know, of sensation is keeping the body healthy. For example, when your body, you know, comes in contact with fire, let's say, right, it will burn the body. How do you know that it has come in contact with fire? Through sensation, right? When your stomach is full, you come to know about it through sensation. So in that sense, sensation is useful for maintaining your body, for keeping the body in good health, right? So this is one of the use of sensation. So sensation is important, right? But it cannot be the source of continuous happiness. Similarly, the excitement, right? The excitement is a temporary happiness, not the continuous happiness. Domination, right? We tend to dominate because we think that domination will give us happiness. But instead of giving happiness, it causes more unhappiness, more opposition, therefore unhappiness. What leads to happiness is coexistence and complementarity. So domination cannot be the source of happiness at all, right? The complementarity, the coexistence can be the source of happiness. Similarly, the fulfillment of all desire cannot be source of happiness because we don't even know what is this all desires, right? And whether they are really useful, meaningful or not. So what is important is the fulfillment of the right desires. So we need to know what are our right desires and we have to fulfill that. That will lead to happiness. So now we have identified that ultimately the desire is for happiness, prosperity and its continuity. And that is all. So if we ensure the fulfillment of that, of course, we'll be in a state of continuous happiness. So these are the prevailing notions, right? So these are the prevailing notions about happiness. With right understanding, we can put them in right place and of course see that these are not the source of continuous happiness, right? So these things are not the source of continuous happiness. But of course, they are useful, right? With right understanding, we can have a placement for them, right? So they have a placement, right? So this is regarding the existing notions of happiness. So now if we look at the notions which are prevailing and the notions which is based on right understanding of happiness, right, this is how it looks like, right? So I have said difference between happiness and excitement. Excitement, it is what notion we have about happiness. And when we say happiness, we mean the right, you know, notion of happiness. So if you look at the right notion of happiness, right, it has to do with harmony. And this harmony can be ensured by way of right understanding in the self. And it can be ensured by way of right feeling in the self. Both are in the self, right? Right understanding in the self and right feeling in the self in relationship with other human beings, right? So right understanding means understanding the harmony at all levels of being, that is individual, family, society, nature and existence. And right feeling has to do with trust, respect, affection, care, guidance and so on. So if we have the right understanding, we are in a state of continuous happiness because we are in harmony within. If we have the right feeling based on right understanding, right, we can be in a state of continuous happiness because these feelings can be ensured in the self in a continuous manner. So these two can be the source of continuous happiness. On the other hand, this excitement can be a source of only temporary happiness and not the continuous happiness. So this sensation through body, like sound, touch, form, taste and smell, can be a source for excitement, temporary happiness, right? And the expression of feeling from the other can also be an excitement, a temporary source of happiness, right? So that is the difference between the happiness and the notion of happiness that we have today, that is excitement. So with this, now we can just sum up, right? So if you look at the prevailing notions, the one notion is happiness is getting favorable sensation from other, from outside. Happiness is getting favorable feeling from other. These are the two prevalent notions. And as we saw, it does not work for continuous happiness. Number two, prosperity is accumulation of physical facility. And if you talk about how much, unlimited. This also does not work for prosperity because unless we know how much of physical facility is required, we do not know whether we have more than what is required or not in regard of how much we accumulate. So instead of leading to prosperity, it leads to a feeling of deprivation. And the impact of this prevailing notion with human being is in terms of domination, exploitation, opposition, struggle and war. And with rest of nature, it results into exploitation of the nature, the rest of nature, leading to resource depletion, pollution, global warming, climate change, and so on. Right? So that is where we are stuck with our prevailing notions of happiness and prosperity. Number one, we are not able to ensure continuity of happiness and prosperity. Number two, we are creating so much of a problem for ourselves, for other human beings, and for rest of nature. Now, if you look at the correct notion, what we find is that having the right understanding and right feeling in the self leads to harmony, which is happiness. Second, the feeling of having more than required physical facility leads to the feeling of prosperity. And this is possible for each and every human being. That we will see as we go along, we'll see. It is possible to ensure this happiness, continuity of happiness, you know, for every human being through right understanding and right feeling in the self. And it is also possible to ensure prosperity for every human being, every family, right? Because our needs are limited and the resources which are available is far more than what is required in the nature. This we will see as we go along. So with this, the background, before we come to the question, let me list out the homework which you have to start working upon. Number one, find out the root cause of problems that you see around yourself, right? Which you have already mentioned, right? But you have to find it out for yourself. The problem that you see around in the people, the problem that you see around with the rest of nature, right? List down those problems, find out the root cause. Is it, you know, related to our wrong notion of happiness and prosperity, right, and the way to go about it. Second, explore the proposal about happiness and prosperity. Find out if they hold true for you or not. So this we have proposed, we have asked you to verify, but you have to look deeper into it and see for yourself whether the definition of happiness and prosperity holds good for you or not. Third, find out if your program is for happiness through harmony or through excitement. So find out whether your program is for harmony or for excitement. So happiness through harmony or happiness through excitement. Thank you very much.